You're so worthy, God. How many know we serve an awesome, worthy God? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We are so excited for you guys to be here with us tonight. Hallelujah. How many came to worship the Lord? We're just going to do some worship songs. You can stand up and worship with me. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you, God. We bless your name, God. We magnify you, Jesus. We honor you tonight, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence. You can say it, that's right. Living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Yes. Your very word spoken to me. Let me hear you. Sing your praise to God. Let me hear you. I'm desperate for. How many are desperate for him right now? Oh, Lord, we bless you. Oh, and I. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to a beautiful melody all over this being. Hallelujah, Jesus. Say, I'm desperate for you. I'm desperate for you. I'm desperate for you. Come on and say, I'm desperate for you. I'm desperate for you. I'm desperate for you. we're desperate for you tonight, God. Hallelujah, God. We're so desperate for you, God. If it weren't for you on our side, Lord, we wouldn't know where we'd be right now, God. But Lord, meet your breath in our lungs as we pray out of praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. I pray in you, Jesus. Jesus, hallelujah. We bless you, Jesus. Jesus, hallelujah, Jesus. We bless you. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus.
It's your breath in our lungs as we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs as we pour out our praise to you, Lord. It's your breath.
There you go.
In our lungs as we pour. In our lungs, as we pour out our praise to you, oh, it's your breath, it's your breath. In our lungs, as we pour out our praise, pour out our praise, it's your breath. In our lungs, as we pour out our praise to you, holy, it's your breath. In our lungs, there you go, as we pour out our praise, pour out our praise, in your breath. In our lungs, as we pour out our praise to you only. Greater.
I believe somebody know that God is great in this house tonight. Feel it. I know y'all know he's great, because I know he's great. Oh, let me sing, great are you, Lord. I can't count the ways, but I know that you are great, Lord. Hey, it's your breath. It's your breath. One minute on the music, if you don't mind.
Oh,
You tonight. God, you're so awesome. Lord, as we give our praise from our heart right now, God, pouring out everything to you, God, right now. Thanking you for healing us, God, for bringing us through, God. Hallelujah. For keeping us, God. Hallelujah. You're so good. You're so awesome. We can't repay you, Lord. And we can't thank you enough for what you've done for us. Come on and keep worshiping and give God the praise. Hallelujah.
Amen. Come on, give God a praise. Amen. Come on, give him a praise. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, the Bible said that everything that have breath, praise the Lord. Come on and praise him. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad. How many people rejoicing today? The Bible says it's good and pleasant for brethren to dwell together in unity. Amen. The Bible said it's like the oil. How many people want God's oil to flow in your life today? Amen. The oil that flowed from Aaron's head to his beard to the uttermost parts of his garment. We're excited to be here today. How many people are excited today? How many people came expecting a miracle from God? Hallelujah. So we are just excited today. I am Pastor Corey. Hallelujah. We want to welcome Kingsway. Give Kingsway a hand clap of praise today. I was just talking to Pastor Hooper back there just a minute ago. Amen. He's on fire. He's ready to do a work for the Lord today. And so we're excited today. Amen. And I'm here to tell you what these cards are about. Amen. How many people have a car? Anyone need your cars? This is something that we do, and we've seen God move in a miraculous way with these cars. Amen. And so if you don't have a car, they'll bring you one if you need one. But I'm just going to go over what these cards mean, what they represent. And I'm going to talk about the red card first. This is for confession of our sins and repentance. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to do what? To forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So these cards are where you write down your sins, the things that you fall short. We all fall short, amen? For all have fallen short, or all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. So this is where we confess, and we burn these up because when we confess it and we ask God to forgive us, we don't worry about it anymore, amen? So we have our blue cards. This is our prayer cards, and you can go ahead and start filling those cards out. Write your confessions down on this red card, and the blue card is where you write your prayer requests. Amen. How many people believe that the prayers of the righteous avail much? The Bible said that men should always do what? Pray, and to pray without ceasing. Amen. So this is where you write your prayer requests, and not just about you. The Bible says pray for one another so that you can be healed. Amen. So think about your coworkers, your family, your neighbors, somebody that needs prayer, amen? And write those requests down. The prayer warriors are going to pray over this, and they're going to decree and declare God's that he'll move in a miraculous way, that he's a God that answers prayer, amen? And also we have the white cards. This is where you write your praise reports. We expect when we ask God to do something that he's going to do it. Amen? The Bible says his ears are attentive to the prayers of the righteous, and he's watching over his word to perform it. Amen? So write your prayer reports down, your praise reports down on these cards, because we want to know when God moves, we want to know that God's done it. Amen? We want to know that our prayers are effective. Amen? And so we're going to have, and also your offering, you may have offering envelopes. You can, Bishop is going to come up later on, and you're going to be able to bring those prayer requests and your praise reports and all that, and you'll be able to put it in those boxes that match these colors that you filled out. And so we're going to have a dance. Hallelujah. There's going to be a dance, and then Pastor Hooper's going to come up, and he's going to minister. Amen. Come on, y'all, get excited. He's going to come up and he's going to minister what God has put on his heart. I can already tell it's going to be good. It's going to be, he's a powerful man of God, and I just met him. Amen. Somebody clap your hands and begin to give God a hand clap of praise. So we're going to have a dance that's going to come up. Somebody's going to do a dance. Minister Shante, I believe. And then Pastor is going to come up and he's going to minister what God has put on his heart. Let's give her a hand clap of praise as she comes. Amen.
I say like this, I say,
Lord, fix it for me. Anybody know that only God can do it? Oh, fix it for me. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Because, Lord, I have a problem that only you can solve.
Play that for me.
Yeah!
need God to do something right now. Come on, say, God, I need you to do it right now. God, I need you to do it right now.
Come on, wasn't that awesome? Let's give it up for Minister Shantae. Come on. Wasn't that awesome? And come on, let's thank the Lord for Minister Carrie and Minister Corey. Didn't they just do a fantastic job leading us in the presence of the Lord? Amen. Hey, we're just so thankful to be here tonight. How many of you are expecting tonight? How many of you are thankful that He prepares a table before our enemies? Amen. Listen, even when you find yourself walking through a valley, there's great news. There's a table on the other side. Isn't that right, Jim? Come on, isn't that right? And I just want to tell you how thankful we are to be here with you tonight. You know, Guiding Light is a body. It's a family that is near and dear to my heart, the heart of our house. And, of course, Bishop and I have had the opportunity over the years to do a lot of things together personally. He's been a big part of our prophetic roundtables, and he's had me be a part of his gatekeeper gatherings. And, of course, you know, Elder Hogan and the team, we used to minister together, ministering to the needs of our community with food ministry. And we got great friends, Teresa and Deshaun. Are they here tonight? Wow, come on now. Come on, thank the Lord for Teresa and Deshaun. Come on. You know, I don't know where Deshaun gets all them bow ties, but I want a couple. Amen. You know, and the first time I ever was at a basketball game with Teresa, I was like, that's my sister from another mister. Hallelujah. But, you know, David said in Psalm 133, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell together in unity. Amen? And how many of you know that Jesus prayed that we would be one as He and the Father are one? And so tonight, not only is Jesus going to answer so many of your prayers, but we also, in our coming together, we get to play a part in answering the prayer of Jesus. And David said in Psalm 133, it's oil poured on the head. How many of you are thankful for the oil? Amen? Thankful for the oil, and that's part of what the Lord has really been speaking to me today for tonight. I'll be sharing that after Bishop ministers communion with us, but there's a blessing tonight on the bread, on the breaking of the bread, the blessing of the bread, the breaking of the bread. There's a blessing on the wine. How many of you are thankful for the blessing of new wine? And there's a blessing of the oil. And so I just want to agree with the Holy Spirit tonight. I was going to say I wanted to welcome the Holy Spirit, ask Him to come, but He's already here. How many of you know He's here? Why don't we just stand to our feet in honor of the Holy Spirit tonight? Holy Spirit, we love you. We love you, Holy Spirit. And I thank you for the privilege to gather together tonight in unity with you. Holy Spirit, we thank you in advance for everything that you've prepared. God, we thank you for the answered prayers that we're going to see tonight. God, we thank you for the move of the Holy Spirit, for this powerful touches of healing and miracles. God, we thank you for an outpouring of hope tonight. God, we thank you for breakthrough. And we thank you for making a way even where there seems to be no way. But we thank you, Lord, that not only are you the door, but you go before us. And so we thank you tonight for the ways that you have gone before us. And we're simply here to follow your lead. We give you the service, Holy Spirit. Because we know that every time you show up, you glorify Jesus. And so we want to join with you tonight, Holy Spirit, in bringing glory to our King. Glory to our Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for the invitation to come to this table tonight to remember what Jesus Christ did for us with the breaking of His body, the pouring out of His blood. As we drink tonight of that cup of the new covenant and we feast upon the goodness of God in Jesus' name. I'm going to ask you to go ahead and bring those prayer cards up that Minister Corey spoke about earlier. And as you bring those down and also take of the communion elements, and you can hold on to this communion elements, of course, and return to your seat. And then Bishop is going to minister communion to us. Amen. Thank you.
what the Bible tells us, how good it is when brethren dwell together in unity. The Word of God says it's like the oil that's poured on Aaron's head, and it flows down from his head down to his beard and down to his outermost garments. When we dwell together in unity. And near the end of that verse, he says, it is there when they dwell together in unity that he commands a blessing. It's not like he's asking. He commands it. Tonight we've come together. If you just look at this audience and what we got, we're two churches. But there's actually only one church. There's one Lord. There's one baptism. And what we fail to do in the natural is we fail to realize the brotherhood of all those who have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Second Corinthians 5:17 says this: if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. We know that scripture. You've been born again. And unless you've been born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. But we have missed the reality of being born again when Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:16, because we have been born again, we no longer regard anyone according to the flesh, according to the way the world sees things. As many as received them, him, he gave the right to become children of God. When I say that we are one church, we've got to stop being a divided church. We've got to see ourselves as one, as the brotherhood of all mankind, of those who accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. We've got to stop regarding one another according to the flesh. We got to stop having a black church and a white church. We've got to stop having a church for rich people and a church for poor people. In Christ, we are all one. In Christ, the rich man should sit alongside of the poor man and make no distinction, because all of us are God's children. There's no greater than and no less than. And if there is any greater, it's the one who's the greater servant. None of us should think of ourselves as being all that and a bag of chips. Because the only one that is all that is our Lord and Savior Jesus. We must learn to respect our differences and recognize that there's only one thing that matters. When I meet a person, all that matters is, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And if you do, I don't know, I don't care whether you're rich or whether you're poor. I don't care whether you're black or whether you're white. I don't care whether you're intelligent or you dumb as Dora. You are my brother or you are my sister. Because we don't regard one another according to the way of the world. And we've got to learn how to do that, brothers and sisters of God. And it was on the night that he was betrayed. The Bible tells us this. When he had given thanks, he took the bread and he said, this is my body, which is broken for you, and do this in remembrance of me. I'm rehearsing that for a moment to let you know. And then he said, he took the cup and he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. And he said, do this. And as often as you do it in remembrance of me. But there's something Paul also says down in there. He says this. Now, each man should judge himself to make sure before he takes of these elements that he takes it worthily. Discerning the body of Christ. I just gave you a word saying the body of Christ is all of us. No distinction. Seeing nothing that separates us. We are one in Christ. And that if we cannot see that, then we will find judgment. Because the reason the world is doing as much as the world is doing is because we're not unified. Satan is unified. He's after all of us. And most of all, he's after our children. And we've got to learn to unify, and we need to judge ourselves whether we're making distinctions, natural distinctions between us. Well, I'm of this church. I have been baptized by immersion. I've been baptized by sprinkling, and we separate ourselves. The reason Satan is able to do what he's doing is because we are not unified. Tonight, Pastor Jason and I, we have agreed that we are one. We are one body. This is the joining and the unifying tonight in communion service of the Guiding Light Church and Kingsway Church. Brothers and sisters in Christ, no other distinction to separate us. We are one. And so Paul said we must judge ourselves. And tonight, before we take this communion element, I want everyone, you've already turned in your cards about where you're confessing. And if you haven't completed a card and you need to do one, you still have opportunity. You confess your sins with the red card. You give God praise report with the white card. And a prayer request that will be prayed over by our prayer warriors with a blue card. You still have opportunity to do that before this service is over. But right now in corporate prayer, everyone must judge themselves. Don't think about your neighbor. Don't think about anybody else. You judge yourself as to whether you are about to partake of the body and the blood of Christ in a worthy manner. That there is nothing in you that makes you see any difference between a brother or a sister in Christ. We rid ourselves of any anger. We rid ourselves of any jealousy, any envy. We rid ourselves of anything that causes division among the body. So I'm going to invite you to look around right now in this room at one another that's here. And when you look at the others that are in this room, I want you to think to yourself, these are my brothers and my sisters. We may not know each other right now, but one day we'll know each other as brothers and sisters. And we'll know each other by name. Because we will rightly discern by the revelation of God, and then we will rejoice when we come together again in the kingdom of God. But you're going to pray right now if there's anything that's, as you've already put the cards in, but if there's anything you need to confess, you're going to do that right now. So for about a moment or so, pray for yourself. Lord, if you find anything in me that's unworthy, purge me. Cleanse me. I'm about to take communion. I am about to become one with you. Make sure you have nothing out against anyone. Make sure nothing separates you from the body of Christ. That if we judge ourselves, we will not come under judgment. Pray. Paul told us that because we don't rightly discern, for this reason, many are weak, sick, and some have already gone to sleep. Let it not be tonight that that can be said of you. Purge yourself, cleanse yourself, ask God, the Holy Spirit, to point out what you need to dismiss, what you need to eliminate, and say, Lord, give me the strength to get over that challenge. Give me the ability to overcome, because you've already said, I can do all things through you who strengtheneth me. I can let go of the remorse. I can let go of the anger. I can let go of the regret. I can let go of the jealousy. I can let go of the unforgiveness. And because Paul said the negative things, the positive are just the reverse. If we confess Christ, then let the weak say, I am strong. And let the poor say, I am rich. And because we've confessed Christ, we can confess tonight, I have life abundantly. I might not have it like the world has it, but I don't need what the world has. All I need is Jesus. And I've got more than enough. So confess now. Because in a moment, as we take up the body of Christ, we take up his strength. We take up his blood. We take up his power. Everyone pray now. I'm going to invite my elders to come up to the platform. I'm going to ask Pastor Jason to come out too. You're still praying, and if you have to, you write a card, whatever you need to do, do it now. Because Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, the Bible tells us very clearly, he got up from the table and he proceeded to wash the disciples' feet. So what I'm going to do here, we have a basin. And each one, we're going to wash our hands, symbolizing washing, Jesus washing the feet. I present that to you right now, just symbolizing washing. In the name of Jesus, we do this. In the name of Jesus, we trust. The washing is the cleansing and the washing of the word. We don't judge ourselves according to what we think of ourselves. This reminds us of the laver. The laver, when you look at it, it was shining. You look in and you see your face and recognize yourself there. But what we need to do when we go to the laver and we wash, it represents the word of God. When we look in this, we need to stop seeing ourselves and we need to see the image of Christ in the way we conduct ourselves with one another. We should reflect the image of Christ because we are to conform to his image. Passover is coming in just a few days. And in every Jewish home representing Passover, the lights of the candles are lit by the woman of the house. My wife is going to come and light the candles of the menorah, representing what Christ did on the night he was betrayed and what every Jewish home would do at Passover, the lighting of the candles. And if you'll come light the candles now. Why do they light the candles? They light the candles because in the very beginning, it was because of a woman that the light of the world went out. The Holy Spirit was here everywhere. But man decided to do something different, and it started with a woman. And so the light of the world went out. But it was also through a woman named Miriam that the light came back in. So that's the reason she has lit the candle. And in the Jewish home, she does a blessing over the flame and pronounces,
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech haolam asher kitzanu bar mitzvata velotom lanu ad Yahshua HaMashiach bar si bar nuino yarlom. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, ruler of the universe, who has set us apart by his word and who has given us Yeshua, the Messiah, and has commanded us to be a light into the world.
the light comes back. We are to be witnesses of Christ. So every time we see the light, or whenever we see a flame like this, we need to remember who we've been called to be. No longer me, no longer Jim Lowe. A child of God is what I need to be. Dismissing everything I've ever learned from the world, because nothing of the world is of any value. And at the table, when the light was lit that night, and remember, you might say, well, I've only seen the 12 disciples at the Last Supper, or the 12 apostles. That's what some man drew for you. Don't you realize that Jesus and his disciples were there? And that included women. There is no male or female in the kingdom of God. We have to understand that we are all one in him. At the Jewish home and there at Passover was the unleavened bread. It wasn't those big loaves like you see on the picture too. It was matzah bread, because it couldn't have any leaven in it to puff it up, which means we're not to be puffed up for who we are. We are all one in Christ. And if you look at the bread, we take the bread and you'll see that it's pierced and it's striped. That should say a lot to the brotherhood, to know that our Lord was pierced and he was striped. Another thing about it is that in this cover that I have, there are three pieces of bread. As you can see, there are two, and this is, I took the middle one out. And this is what the Jews do. They take the middle one out. And they say the first piece of bread represents Abraham, the second one represents Isaac, and the third one represents Jacob. But for us as Christians, with the revelation of God that we have, the first piece represents the Father, the second piece represents the Son, and the third piece represents the Holy Spirit. In a Jewish home, they take the second piece, and they take that second piece, and they break it, and they hide that piece that they've broken. They call it the aphikomen. And they hold up the remaining piece and they said, by whom this bread's name represents, we are healed. They don't realize it, but we do, that the second piece is not just Isaac, it is Jesus Christ. And so they give honor to God through Christ when they hold up the second piece, which is what we do too. And it is taken from one cloth, the three pieces in one. They don't see it like we do, but we understand three in one: God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then we take the cup. The cup, Jesus, as we know, says, it is my blood. It is the new covenant that I make with you. Now watch this. The light that we've added back represents God the Father. The bread represents God the Son. And what do you think the cup represents? It's fruit of the vine. And you know what fruit of the vine can do to you if you make it just right. And what do we call that? They call them spirits. But we know it's one spirit. The spirit of Almighty God called the Holy Spirit. And so we understand the fruit of the vine as representing the Spirit, the bread representing the body, and the light representing the Father. And there's something that we started doing at Guiding Light. We have added also the anointing oil, representing the Spirit of God. That the oil, you see, as I have it placed by the menorah, the light lights because of the oil. And when you've been anointed with oil, you need to consider yourself having been lit up, so that your light will shine. And let it shine. And the more anointing, the greater the fire, the greater the flame. You ever run into folk like that sometimes? Every time you see, they don't have to say, oh, Jesus, bless the name, your Lord, God, hallelujah. No, you can just look at them and you see something's different about them. That's the anointing. Yes. You see, that's like the woman had heard about Jesus, and she had 12 years of bleeding. And she said, but if I just touch the hem of his garment, she wanted the anointing. If you get anything in the world, just get the anointing. Because it's the anointing that shatters the yoke. And so we add this to it, because with the anointing, with the blood, the spirit, and with the body, and with the light of the Lord, can't nobody touch this. MC Hammer ain't got nothing on a child of God. But let me not go on too much, because Pastor Jason is going to bring a word tonight, and we are going to take communion. So you've seen the elements and the items here. So while Jesus took the bread, and I'm going to lift up the bread right now. You get the bread for yourself, and I need to move more hurriedly at this point. He lifted it up as you would lift up Jesus in your life. Lift up your bread, and in your mind now say, I lift you up, Lord. I lift you up. And the Bible says, he lifted it up and he said, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu, Melech HaHalom, Hamotzi Lekamin HaRetz. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. He took it and he broke it. And he said, take, eat. This is my body, which he just reminded me. I am depriving my elders. I'm being disrespectful. Thank you. All right. And go ahead and take the bread as you do it. I guess I have just proven that sometimes the first shall be last. And so we take up the body of Christ. Now, when we take up the body of Christ, here, strengthen yourself in knowing this. He says, these signs shall follow those that believe on my name. And one of those things is that they shall lay hands on the sick. Amen. Tonight, as we go through this service, you have the body of Christ. And if you have the body of Christ, do you think there's any sickness in the body of Christ? You think there's any weakness in the body of Christ? Let us begin to believe. The reason you don't receive is because you don't have faith. The faith we build with communion. We do that tonight. And then he took the cup, the Bible says, which is called the Kiddush. And he lifted it up and he said, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Borei Pri Hagafen, which means blessed are you, Adonai, our God, ruler of the universe, creator of the fruit of the vine. And what we symbolize by this, the fruit of the vine, creator, that whatever you need, God can create it for you. There's no lack. And Jesus said, now take and drink, for this is the blood of the covenant. And we got a better covenant than anyone else. Take it and drink. So to every one of us, as we take up this communion right now, we recognize the Father. We recognize the Son. And the Holy Spirit. Oh, and there's one other thing I want to tell you. I'm going to break this bread. Well, I can't break it twice, but nevertheless, they take the one part that was broken and they're going to hide it. They wrap it up. Let me tell you what the Jews do on Passover. They wrap it up in a cloth and then they go hide it somewhere. Think of it, the piece of bread hidden in the cloth. And they go hide it from the children. And then they tell the children to go look for it. And the one who finds it receives a blessing from the father of the house. That second piece represents Christ, who was hidden, wrapped in a cloth, and was hidden. And those who found him, which represents us, receive a blessing from the Father. So what we symbolize in our communion service is Jesus Christ available to all of us. Tonight, we're thankful that we've had Kingsway with us to participate in this service, as I've delivered to you an abbreviated form of the communion service that we at Guiding Light do every month in the evening. And why in the evening? Because if you read your Bible very clearly, it says on the night that he was betrayed. We make it convenient for ourselves. But I'll simply say this. If we're going to conform to the image of Christ and pattern our life after his, it wasn't convenient for him to come from heaven. He went out of his way to save us. Is it too much to ask for us to go out of our way to serve him? So, Father, I thank you right now for sending your son so that we might have life. I thank you now, Lord, for bringing us together to be unified as one. Now, Lord, with the ministry of your word, break yokes, give deliverance, set us free, unify us, bless us in the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach Jesus, and let the whole church say amen. As we now receive a blessing from our pastor tonight, Jason Hooper.
That incredible. Wasn't that amazing? So beautiful. So beautiful. And not only was that beautiful, but you're beautiful. I just feel like that nights like tonight really bring Jesus a whole lot of glory. He loves this. How many of you love this? How many of you love the things that Jesus loves? The fear of the Lord is to love what Jesus loves. To hate the things that he hates. Never hate people, but at the same time to be able to speak truth with love to anything that would separate others from his love. Amen? It actually said in Hebrews 1:9 that Jesus was anointed with the oil of joy or the oil of gladness. And I believe that that's part of what God wants to do for each and every one of us tonight, is a fresh anointing. A fresh anointing of that oil of joy, that oil of gladness. And as I was praying for each of you this afternoon, and Bishop and I spent some time talking this afternoon, and I went into just a real quick vision after I hung up the phone with him, and I saw a door. And I believe it's a door that God has set before us tonight. How many of you are thankful that in Revelations 4, John saw a door set up in heaven? He said, come up here. And I believe that the Lord is inviting us into a higher perspective, because Psalm 2:4 says, those who sit in heaven, they what? They laugh. Amen? There's a heavenly perspective. In the midst of what's going on in the world around you, we are seated in heavenly places, and joy is the primary emotion of those heavenly places. Amen? How many of you are thankful for the blessing of the wine, the blessing of the cup, that the blood speaks a better word? Amen? How many of you are thankful for the blessing of the bread, that his body was broken, that ours doesn't have to be? Amen? You know, and even today, come on, let's thank the Lord for the body and the blood. Hallelujah. And as I was just thinking today with the Lord and just pondering tonight, and the Lord spoke about three different things that he wanted to release a blessing from tonight: the blessing of the bread, the blessing of the wine, and the blessing of the oil. Amen? See, the blessing of the bread, when Jesus blessed that young boy's lunch, one boy with two fish and five loaves, after Jesus had been preaching many days, just like some of us, amen, hallelujah. Have you ever preached long enough where people got hungry? My people bring snacks, amen. They do. They bring a purse and they bring a lunchbox, amen. Amen. I mean, Paul preached until he fell out of the window, right? Amen. There's grace. That's what I tell myself. Hallelujah. I'm always thankful when the clock in the back runs out of batteries, amen. We've had it switch over to military time a couple times, amen. But that young boy with the two fish and the five loaves, when he brought that to Jesus, he blessed it. He looked to heaven. He gave thanks because he knew what God was about to do. And regardless of what you have in your hand, when you give it to Jesus and you begin to give thanks, it's always more than enough. Amen? And so he blessed the bread and he broke it. And as he handed it to his disciples, it was multiplied in their giving away. And one of the things in the kingdom is everything is given to us in seed form. How many of you know that? But it's multiplied as we begin to give it away to others. as we begin to give away Jesus, as we begin to minister from the anointing to those in need, to see every yoke destroyed, every burden removed. Amen? So he blessed the bread and he broke it, and 5,000 families were fed. But not only that, those 12 disciples, they each had a basket where they were able to pick up the fragments. And it said that those baskets were full and overflowing of fragments, because they didn't just see a ministry of multiplication, they received a ministry of multiplication. And I believe that part of what God wants to do in the blessing of your bread is to bring you in, to invite you in to that ministry of multiplication in this season. How many of you want to move from subtraction and division beyond addition into multiplication? Amen. And Jesus, you know, multiplication is the only math he knows. Satan operates in division, but Jesus brings multiplication. See, my Bible says when a thief comes in one way, that he flees seven ways before your face. And if he tries to take something, he's got to pay back sevenfold, even out of his own house. He takes one and has to pay back seven. Amen. How many of you are ready for some payback tonight? Some divine recompense. It's the goodness of God. It's the glory of Jesus Christ. I remember those two men on the road to Emmaus, and you know, they were walking along the road, and actually one of the women actually that came to minister to Jesus, when the angel said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" Which is a great word for us as well, amen. Why do we look for the living? Why do we look for the heavenly among the earthly? Why do we look for the living among what's been? Why do we look for what will be among what was, amen? How many of you have been in a season where God has been challenging you to let go so that you can lay hold, amen? To cast aside some things that would entangle you in the coming season. But there was two men walking on the road to Emmaus. It only gives us the name of one. And my personal belief is the reason why we only have the name of one is because the other was his son. I believe it was a father and a son walking on that road of Emmaus. And as they were talking about Jesus, just like we are tonight, Jesus himself drew near. How many of you feel the presence of Jesus here? See, every time you talk about Jesus, you begin to recognize that he's already in your midst. Mark 16, 20 says that God worked with them with accompanying signs and wonders. When you talk about healing, people get healed. When you talk about angels, angels begin to... Because how many of you know there's more angels in here than people, amen? But when we begin to give honor to those heavenly hosts and begin to recognize that they are ministering spirits sent for us, amen. They're part of salvation. It says that angels are actually not just winds, but he makes ministers a flame of fire, and that they're a part of the inheritance in salvation. You have some angels that want to be put to work. Amen. Psalm 103:20 says, "Bless the Lord, you his angels who excel in strength, heeding the voice of his word." And see, the way that the angels go to work on your behalf is simply by speaking the word over your life. Speaking the scripture, that word that will not return void, but will accomplish what he sent it to do. Amen. It'll prosper in this place. And I'm so thankful for one church tonight with two campuses. Amen. I'm so thankful for one body with many members. Amen. Because in Jesus, we are all one. But those two men who are walking on the road to Emmaus, they were thinking about what they lost because they were looking with temporal eyes. They didn't understand the resurrection. They just understood what it was like to walk with him while he was here, not recognizing it was to their benefit for him to go so he could send the Holy Spirit so we could become just like Jesus. And as Jesus drew near with them on the road to Emmaus, it said they got to where they were going, and he indicated he would have gone farther. But they said, "Abide with us." I want to tell you, listen, it's amazing when you have a desire to get God to abide with you. But my question is, how much farther does God want to go? See, it's one level to say, "Jesus, abide with us." It's another to say, "I want to go where you're going." Amen. How many want to go tonight with where God wants to go? Because it's glory to glory. It's faith to faith. And a lot of times we can see based on where we are, but he sees based on where he wants to take us. But he said that just in the kindness of Jesus, he came into them and he blessed the bread again and he broke it. And what happened when he broke that bread? Their eyes were opened and they knew him. See, on the road, they knew about him. But when he blessed the bread, they knew Jesus. They didn't have a knowledge about God, but they knew him face to face. And they said, "Wait a minute, did not our hearts burn within us?" And one of the things I feel like that God has really wanted to do with this blessing of the bread tonight is he's wanted to bring that burn back. That righteous heart burn, hallelujah. Come on, that fire of first love, amen? How many of you remember when Jesus first touched you and all you could think about was Jesus? Everywhere you went, all you could talk about was Jesus.
You weren't worried about where you needed to go. You weren't worried about your to-do list. You weren't worried about this and you weren't worried about that. Everything was about Jesus. And there's something about the blessing of the bread where it's all coming back to Jesus. It's all coming back to what moves his heart, what he desires to do in the earth, where he gets center stage. The blessing of the bread. How many of you want to see your bread broken tonight? How many of you want to see that your eyes open to where you could begin to see him in a new way through that spirit of wisdom and revelation that Paul prayed for? How many of you say, God, I want my heart to burn again tonight? I believe that he's going to set some hearts on fire tonight because those angels are here. I feel them. I was seeing some things earlier when we were praying, and I want to tell you, those angels are here as winds to make you a flame of fire. Just like Bishop was talking about. Listen, the oil, the anointing, it is costly, it is precious, but once you get it, you're set on fire. Amen? Once you get it, you're like Aretha Franklin. What you want, baby, we got it. Amen? Once he touches you, you become a touch for others. Amen? And so God is going to minister to us tonight that blessing of bread to open our eyes to begin to see him. Many of you have seen in the spirit, but I want to tell you, God wants all of us to begin to see in the spirit. That we would not just see with our natural eyes like Elisha's servant. We would not just see those who are against us, but our eyes would be open to see those who are for us. To recognize that we are not alone, but he has gone before us and he has angels assigned to us in this season. How many of you are thankful for that? And then the Lord is speaking about the blessing of the wine. How many of you know it says in Isaiah 65:8 that new wine, not the old wine, but the new wine is in the where? It's in the cluster, hallelujah. Come on, Jordan, Kingsway College student, amen, hallelujah. He's heard this before. See, a lot of times, even at our place, I'll say, hey, guys, listen, we're sitting too far apart. They said, what do you mean? I said, new wine's in the cluster. You got to get all the grapes together, intimately connected to one another and rightly connected to him. You know, listen, when 120 people jammed into a prayer meeting, hallelujah, it wasn't a great big sanctuary. I bet it was uncomfortable. About day 7, they probably started to stink a little bit, hallelujah. They hadn't brushed their teeth or their tooth. Anybody with teeth or tooth, hallelujah. But how many of you know, sometimes it's in the uncomfortable place God does an uncommon thing. It's not in the place of our comfort, but we begin to pursue an uncommon call. Saying, I want to get out of what feels comfortable in my flesh so that I could be set free from this carnal way. But he said there's a blessing in that cluster. In fact, this is what it said in Isaiah 65:8, the blessing of the wine. Thus says the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and one says, do not destroy it, for the blessing is in it. The blessing that comes in the unity of the brethren. The oil poured on the head, running down the beard, flowing through the garment. Bishop shared with us earlier how it's a place of what? Commanded blessing. You know what that blessing is? Life forevermore. And that word life forevermore, if you actually were to look at that word life in the Hebrew, it means appetite. It means abundance, and it means hunger. And how many of you are hungry for more of him tonight? You see, listen, if you're not hungry, you can get hungry. See, in the natural, we get hungry when we don't eat. But in the kingdom, you get hungry by what you feed yourself. When you begin to feed yourself on the word of God, the goodness of God, when you start talking to yourself about what God says instead of talking to yourself about what somebody else said, amen? When you begin to change the narration to, well, this is what God said, so this is what I'm going to speak, and if I speak it, I'll see it, because if we say what he said, they will see what he said. Amen? And see, you are God's voice in the earth. You're his hands. You're his feet. We are his body, and he's looking for a place to rest. Amen? So the blessing of the bread, the blessing of the wine, the blessing. How many of you know that healing is the children's bread? When Bishop first reached out to me, he called and he said, hey, listen, I was talking and praying with my elders, and we just said, hey, listen, let's do something different. And they said, we got an idea for different. Why don't you call Pastor Jason? It don't get more different than that. Hallelujah. And so Caleb, my son, and I, we were working out and hitting it, and I got a text from Bishop, and Caleb goes, oh, I love Bishop. He said, call him back. And so I called him right back. And he started to tell me, and I said, listen, what came to my heart was hope and healing. I said, I feel like that God just wants to minister hope to his people. Because how many of you know that we live in a world where there's not a lot of hope on the outside, but there's more than enough hope on the inside? Jesus is the hope of the world, but Christ in you is the hope of glory. And see, when you begin to live from hope, the glory on the inside gets on the outside. Jesus was asked when the kingdom of God was going to come. He said, it doesn't come with observation.
The kingdom of God is within you. And everything that has pressed you in this season is to produce his wine, his oil, and the breaking of his bread, that place of revelation. That's what those two men on the road to Emmaus got. They got a revelation. But also healing is the children's bread. And there's something about just coming like a child, just coming to him as a good father, expressing the things that we have need of, which we've done with the prayer requests. Being able to recognize that when we mess up, we don't run from God, we run to God. That's what we did with those confession cards, saying, Lord, listen, I'm not just here to just write down what I've been doing. I'm here to say, I don't want to leave with this. If I put it here, I don't have to take it there. I can lay it down and I can never have to pick it up again because your blood speaks a better word. Amen. Your grace is more than enough. In the areas where I've been weak, I will declare that I am strong and I will not compromise my birthright. I will not be an Esau. I will be a Jacob. I'll be those who lay hold of God. But then the Lord started speaking to me about the blessing of the oil. How many of you love the oil? I love that Bishop has added the oil to the communion equation. Amen. Isn't that amazing? I love that you guys have had an anointing service where you've placed the oil upon one another. And I love the oil, but I want to tell you, listen, it's great to have a jar of oil, but it's better to become a vessel of oil. Amen. You know, when Tina and I, when we were first engaged, and I got to share this the other night on Pastor Joshua and Pastor Janet's Greater Glory Gathering, their webinar. Can we thank the Lord for Pastor Joshua and Pastor Janet? Hallelujah. They've got friends with them tonight from Canada, our good friend, the Garcias. And I was sharing, you know, when we were first together, you know, I never left the house without my oil. Has anybody got any oil on them? Let me ask you, does anybody got any oil in you? See, it's great to have oil on you, but it's better to have oil in you. You can have both. Because how many know the Holy Spirit is in you and he's on you and he wants to flow through you? But you know, back then I could only afford one suit. And I think that was given to me. But I never left without that jar of oil. And I remember one time we were at a meeting in North Carolina and I told Tina, I said, man, God is in this place. I smelled the frankincense. Ooh, I smelled the myrrh. I said, man, this is amazing. What I didn't realize was I had not screwed the cap back on my oil. And all of a sudden, my suit became anointed. Hallelujah. And it began to run down my leg. Amen. But guess what? I loved it. I wore that oil-stained suit everywhere. I called it my anointed suit. Amen. And the truth is I had a desire for the genuine. I had a desire. I wanted the oil. I was willing to do anything for the anointing. For more of the person of the Holy Spirit in my life. But it was like in that moment, the Lord was saying, listen, you're not just going to carry me in your pocket. I'm going to get on you to where everybody that gets around you knows I've been with you and you've been with me. And this, in this world, all of creation is groaning for those who have been with Jesus, the manifestation of the sons of God, the revealing of those who know God and do great exploits. Amen. Interestingly, in Joel chapter 2, if you have a Bible, I'm not going to talk long because I want to spend all of our time praying tonight. Come on, how many of you would like to have some prayer tonight? How many of you love the laying on of hands? How many of you believe that something can happen in the anointing? I told Bishop, I said, Bishop, I'd love for you and I just to pray for as many people that need prayer, want prayer. If you need healing, if you need a miracle, if you say, listen, I'm not feeling very hopeful, that we would just pray that the God of hope, how many know this is in Romans 15, 13, that the God of hope would fill you with all joy, not just a little joy, all joy and all peace through the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would abound in hope. That means that you'd be the most hope-filled, hopeful person on the planet. Hallelujah. That people say, what's wrong with them? Why aren't they worried like everybody else? Amen. That every time you step into a situation, regardless of what it looks like, you're like, God's going to work this out. That when you see somebody in a wheelchair, you don't look down at your phone and go this way, but you're like, oh, I got Christ in me, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. When you see somebody with some crutches, you're like, oh, hallelujah. Come on, listen, you are a healing service waiting to happen. Revival is not just something that we pray for and we wait for. Revival is a heart that is set on fire. And when God begins to break bread and your heart begins to burn for him and your eyes are open to see him and you recognize the beauty in the new wine and that you're a carrier of new oil, anything is possible. Anything is possible. But in Joel chapter 2, verse 19, this is what it says. Joel chapter 2, verse 19, Amplified. The Lord will answer and say to his people, behold, I'm going to send you. I'm going to send you grain, that's the bread, new wine, and oil. But it gets better, and you will be satisfied. You will be satiated in full with them. In other words, you're not just going to get a Lunchable when you come into the kingdom. Amen? You're not just going to get a sandwich. You're not just going to get a little Dixie cup. You're not even going to get a to-go communion. You're going to have full access to the buffet of the Father's house. Because all that the Father has, He's made available to us through the person of the Holy Spirit. And what God is wanting to do is He's wanting to so fill our hearts tonight that we can't hold back from filling the earth with His glory. Amen? He goes on in Joel chapter 2 and verse 23. He says, be glad then. Be glad. Rejoice and be glad. Did you know you cannot rejoice and be sad? Did you know that worry and thanksgiving happen in the same place in the brain? Did you know that? And the only way to change what's in your mind is by what's in your mouth. How many of you know that to be true? Here, let's do a little exercise and just test it out. I like to take healings for a test drive. I like to take revelation for a test drive. Sometimes you just got to get it and see how it feels. Amen? Everybody just right now in your mind, just start saying the alphabet to yourself in your mind. Because you say, well, how do I do that? Well, you talk to yourself all day long in your head. Amen? Some of y'all be winning arguments in the shower with somebody at the office. Amen? Amen? Go ahead and start just going through the alphabet in your mind. And then out loud, start counting to 10, beginning with 1. Go. How quickly did your mind stop the alphabet when your mouth started to speak? Instantly. And see, when you make the choice to rejoice, sadness leaves your life. Joy is a choice. It's a faith-based emotion, and it is voice-activated. And listen, it is not happiness is based on what happens to you. Joy is based on what God has done for you. Joy is a declaration that it may look like hell, but God's about to release heaven on earth if I can keep my heart right and I can make the choice to rejoice. I can give Him a praise. Hallelujah. That I can position myself as a gate of God in the earth. As a gate of God. You're a Bethel. How many remember Jacob came to a certain place and he put his head on a certain rock and he saw what? A ladder. He saw a ladder set up on earth with angels, what? Ascending and descending. That means that they're here waiting for somebody to send them there to bring back something. Hallelujah. And then he said, oh my gosh. He goes, God is in this place and I did not know it. That word know means I didn't see it. How many of you recognize that sometimes you can't see God in a situation, but it does not mean He's not there. And what I believe that God wants to do tonight is He wants to open our eyes to see what God is doing in the worst of scenarios. The situations that look like chaos and look like confusion, that we have vision and we have clarity and we have hope and we have faith because we know God. And because of that, we're strong. He goes on, verse 23, be glad. I only got through two words. Hallelujah. Be glad. Then you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for He has given you the former rain faithfully, and He will cause the rain to come down for you. The former rain and the latter rain in the first month. That latter rain is spring rain. How many of you know we're in April, amen? April what? Showers bring May flowers. Listen, y'all, I want to tell you, what's going on in your April is going to cause you to bloom in your May. I want to tell you, listen, the rain is here for you. It's not here against you. And Zechariah 10 says, in the time of rain, ask for more rain. In the time that God begins to water the earth, ask for Him to do even more than He's already done. To give thanks for what He's done, but give Him praise for what He's about to do. And it's the former and the latter beginning to come together. But then He goes on and says, the threshing floors, which speak of harvest, shall be what? Full of wheat, and the vats shall overflow with new wine and oil. This altar is a threshing floor, and you are wheat. You are wheat. How many of you know Jesus in Matthew 13 gave a parable of the sons of the kingdom? And he said that they were, it was the parable of the wheat and the, and He said they looked the same until what? The last day. And He said in that last day, there'll be a distinction between the wheat and the tares. How many know we're in a season of distinction right now? The Lord told us several years ago, I remember it was June, I believe 2021, that we were coming into a season of deception and conception in the body of Christ. And the determining factor would be the father you gave yourself to in intimacy, the father of lights or the father of lies. And how many of you know, listen, The thing about deception is it's deceiving. Sometimes you can think you're right even when you're wrong. But sometimes you can be right and you can say a right thing in a wrong way. Jesus said, be careful what? What you hear and how you hear. Because what goes in will come out, but how you hear it determines the spirit it comes out with. Amen? And so I want to tell you, listen, these threshing floors tonight, get ready to see them full of wheat so that your vat, you're the vat, you're the vessel, can be full of new wine. What is a vat? It's being vulnerable. It's allowing God to touch you. It's letting your walls come down so that he can touch you in the deepest part of who you are. It's being authentic. It's being authentic about where you are and who he is. And it's being transparent. Being transparent. Being a window that is so clean that not only can others see in, but he can see out. And they can say of you, like they said of Peter and John, listen, they're not trained, they're not educated, but they've been with Jesus. Have you ever been around somebody that you knew had been with Jesus? That's one of the things I love about coming here. That's one of the things I love about the gathering of the saints, is finding like-minded, like-hearted people that we may work in different places, we may worship in different places on Sunday, but we have all been with Jesus. And all of creation is groaning for those who have been with Jesus. But verse 25 is what I saw this afternoon. As I was praying, I saw a quick glimpse. How many of you love those quick glimpses in the spirit, those quick visions? And as I hung up the phone with Bishop, I didn't even have a chance to really turn to the Lord in prayer. I was like, I turned and I just had the spirit of prayer on me. How many know with the spirit of prayer, you open your mouth and all of a sudden this intercessory tongue just starts coming out. Hallelujah. It's not a tongue to edify you, but it's a tongue to intercede for others. And I opened my mouth and it came out. And as soon as it did, I saw a quick glimpse and I saw a door called Restore for 2024. And I want to tell you what I believe that God wants to do tonight as we have come to his table, prepared in the presence of every enemy that could ever oppose his promises in your life, is to bring us together for restoration of what God desires to do in our life. How many of you recognize that there's been some interruptions in life? 2020 was an interruption. Did anybody get to have some interruptions? Amen. I believe that God is giving a divine invitation in the place where there's been demonic interruption and interference. Because I believe where there was an interruption, there was an interference to where it made it harder for some people to hear because of all of the other noise. Does anybody ever have trouble hearing certain people speak in a loud room? Right? One of the things that I believe that God wants to do tonight is to silence every other voice that has seemed to speak louder than his. So that when he speaks, we hear that voice behind us saying, this is the way. Walk in it. So he says, so I will restore to you the years the locusts have stolen, the swarming locust, the crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust. How many of you have some years you'd like to see given back? How many of you said, listen, things were going great until, and I want to tell you, God wants to pick up what the enemy interrupted and invite us to step into what we thought was lost with a sevenfold recompense that would accelerate us into the next season, that we would not go by might or by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Amen. And how many of you recognize that when those years are stolen, it's because those years have value? But we can't look back at what's been lost. We have to look forward and recognize that everything that has been lost, we can let go of, because we can reach fully forward to lay hold of what he laid hold of us for. He goes on in verse 28. Verse 27 is great. It talks about how my people will never be put in shame. Can somebody say amen? Amen. I love Isaiah 61:7. It says, instead of your shame, you'll have double honor. Instead of confusion, everlasting joy will be yours. And in your land, you will what? Possess double. Amen? How many of you are believing for some double tonight for your trouble? Amen? But then he goes on to verse 28. He says, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also on my men servants and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. Just like Bishop said, no distinction. No distinction. No distinction. I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth.
blood, fire, and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, the moon into blood, before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. It shall come to pass that what? Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I want to tell you, the Lord told us going into this new year that by April, many people would find themselves in a place of either harvest or war, depending on where they determined to plant their heart. And that we'd be planted either in a place of uncompromising conviction and uncommon clarity, or utter chaos and absolute confusion. And how many of you recognize there are people, even right now, that are in a place of confusion? They need people that have clarity. They need you to step in as the light of the world to give truth where there's been deception. Amen? Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost and he said, this is what Joel prophesied was coming. He said there would be what? Signs in the heavens and wonders in the earth. How many recognize we've had some signs in the heavens even this week? Yeah. Amen? When I see signs in the heavens, we can all look and say, that's amazing. But guess what? Tuesday comes. Wednesday's still coming. Thursday, here we are. And so if there's a sign in the heavens on Monday, that means that we're called to walk in wonders on Tuesday, on Wednesday, and on Thursday, and on Friday. Amen? The word wonder is miracle. And so anytime there's a sign in the heaven, it's God pronouncing that he wants to release miracles in the earth. How many of you here tonight could use a miracle tonight? How many of you need a miracle in your body, a miracle in your finances, a miracle in your heart, a miracle in your home, a miracle in your marriage, a miracle in your finances? That's where the oil comes in. That's where the anointing comes in. Because it'll destroy that yoke. It'll remove that burden. And in the place where you've been heavy and you've been weary, you'll be yoked with him. And everything you do with him from a place of rest. Rest is not inactivity. It's faith. It's trust. It's recognizing that he can do more for you than you could ever do for him. I heard a pastor one time, Tommy Tenney. He said that God can do more for you in one moment of his favor than in a lifetime of labor. And there is a restoration of favor that I believe that God is wanting to open the door to us today. And listen, for many of you, you have experienced a war at that door called restore. How many of you, there's been some challenges already in 2024? That's awesome. That's amazing. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 16:9, that God has set what? A great and effective door before me, but there are many adversaries. And we can either look at what opposes us or look at the opportunity in the open door, recognizing that the enemy is just wanting to appear bigger than he is to keep us from who God is in this hour. Those 10 spies came back talking about the giants. They said, we are grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in theirs. But Joshua and Caleb said, wait a minute, guys. God hasn't changed what he said just because the giants showed up. And one of the things I've learned about in my life, the closer you are to a promise, the bigger the giants appear. You know, from a distance, I could hold Bishop like that. But I get up, I got to hold him like this. Because the closer I get to where I'm going, the bigger it appears. And I want to tell you, if you look like you're facing some big opposition, I got great news for you tonight. When the oil shows up in the place of your opposition, it becomes an opportunity and an open door. 2 Kings 4, there's a widow who comes to Elisha, and she says, my husband, your servant, is dead. What she was saying is, I got a problem, that's your problem. She probably was saying, if you had paid him better, we wouldn't be where we're at. She said, and the debt collectors are coming to take my children. Have you ever had a creditor call and threaten to take your kids? Listen, somebody got excited, hallelujah. Take them, Lord, that's why I'm in debt. Children are a blessing of the Lord. Amen. Happy is the man whose quiver is full of them. Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. Sometimes you say, you rejoice by faith. Amen. She said, they're coming to take my kids. She had a debt she couldn't pay. Does anybody have some debts right now that you feel like you can't pay? Listen, we had a debt that we couldn't pay that Jesus paid on Calvary. We had a debt we couldn't pay, and he allowed a crown of thorns to be put on him and was crucified on the place of the skull, Golgotha. Because what you think you can't pay here, he's already made provision here. The word of faith is near us. It's in our mouth and it's in our heart. And as we begin to allow our heart to swell with joy, we begin to speak that faith into a situation. Watch how the situation comes under the Lordship, and what was the greatest trial will become your greatest triumph. So she said, I've got a debt I can't pay. He said, what can I do for you? And he did not let her answer. He said, what can I do for you? What do you have in your house? She said, I have nothing but a jar of oil. Has anybody ever focused more on what you need than what you've got? Has anybody ever spent more time thinking about your past than your present or your future? Has anybody ever spent more time thinking about what you can't control instead of what you can control? Listen, that's a recipe for disappointment. He said, what can I do for you? What do you have in your house? She said, I got nothing but a jar of oil. And what he knew in that moment was she already had more than enough. All she needed was the word of the Lord. All she needed was to take what was in her hand and trust it in his hand. Because what looks little in your hand is more than enough in his hand. Not only did that young boy find that out with the two fish and the five loaves, but this widow who had a debt that she couldn't pay was about to have an inheritance to give away with one moment. And when I saw this door called Restore in 2024 opened up today, I knew that God was going to do a work of restoration tonight to take us from not just restoring years, but also bringing us out of the bondage of what's been in one moment to where we would walk in empty and we'd walk out full. You might have walked in with your head down, but you're going to walk out with your hands up. Hallelujah. You may have walked in worried, but you're going to walk out in worship. Amen. See, worry and worship start the same way. You can't control what happens to you, but you can make a decision what happens in you. Amen? And the challenge for so many Christians in life is not to allow what happens to you to happen in you so it won't happen through you. Amen? So this was the prophet's word to her. And I think that we're living out this word tonight. Because he said, go to your neighbors. Go to your neighbors. We're neighbors. We're right around the corner. And borrow vessels. This gathering tonight is simply just a vessel. The church is not a building, it's a people. But this is a vessel. And he wants to fit all of us tonight as a vessel. He said, go borrow vessels and don't gather just a few. And after you've gone to all your neighbors, all of the other churches, all of your other friends, all of your other family, after you go knocking all the doors and you gather up all of the other vessels, I want you and your sons to begin to take that little jar that you've got and just start pouring it out. And so, when you read the Bible, do you like picture yourself in it? I've got a wild imagination. Where are my wild imaginations at? Listen, imagination is the soil that miracles grow in. Paul said that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above what you ask or think or imagine according to the power that's at work in you. And imagination is necessary for the working of miracles because you got to see it before it happens, to speak to things that are not as though they are. Amen? And so they come in, they shut the door, and they begin to pour it out. And I picture them kind of going, mm-hmm. And they were kind of doing like a slow pour. Have you ever had more people show up than you had food or you had drink or you had, you know, and so you're kind of giving everybody like a little bit for you and a little bit for you, hoping that you had enough for the last person with a plate? I think that's how the disciples were in John 6. Like Peter's probably like, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But then they recognize, wait a minute, I'm giving it away and it's not getting smaller, it's getting bigger. Because Jesus is the master of multiplication. And he wants to give us the ministry of multiplication tonight in the oil. And that's what the widow found out. That's what her sons found out. Because he said the oil did not cease until the last vessel was full. Isn't that amazing? She comes to Elisha and she said, oh my gosh. She said, that little jar we had was more than enough when we started to pour out what we had. When we started to give away what we've got, it didn't run out until we ran out of places to pour. How many recognize there's no recession up there? There's no inflation. I mean, God is not limited. He is abundance. And God is wanting to bring us into an abundance mindset. An expectation of increase. It says in 2 Corinthians 9:10 that he supplies what? Seed to the sower, and he multiplies what's sown and increases the fruit. Amen? And see, our oil, what we've been given, our life is a seed. And how we give that away to others multiplies his impact in the earth. And so this is what the prophet told her. He said, go sell the oil, and you and your sons pay the debt, and then give it to your sons to live on for their entire life. She went from a debt she couldn't pay to an inheritance she gave away in one moment of obedience when the oil became the focus.
when her perspective was no longer on what she needed, what she lacked, but what she had, when she could give it to him with full surrender. What do you have tonight? What do you have? 1 John 2:27 says you have an anointing from the Holy One. And see, we have been given the Holy Spirit without measure. You've been given the Holy Spirit without measure. And the only measures that we put on him are the measures of our mind, where we limit what he could potentially do if we really begin to live like we believe this Bible. And so tonight, God's going to break that bread. He's going to cause our eyes to see things in this word that either we've never seen or we've never seen in such a life-giving way. He's going to begin to bless that wine to where all of a sudden we begin to not just recognize there's a blessing on the gathering together, but really getting close, really coming together in intimacy, close koinonia fellowship, and giving away that oil that we've been given. To me, the only sad part of that story is they didn't get more vessels. Because as long as there was someone to pour into, the oil did not cease. Amen? And my word for you tonight is that where you have been weeping, get ready to start reaping. And once you start reaping, you're going to start leaping. How many of you know this is a leap year? Psalm 126, David said, when the Lord restored our captivity, when he gave back what had been stolen, we were like those who dream, and our mouth was filled with laughter. And then he begins to talk about all of the great things that God had done for them, all the great things that God had done for others. They were remembering, they were testifying to themselves of who God had been, and they said, God, do it again. And he said this, he said, those who have sown in tears. Has anybody sown some tears? Listen, a leaky head will never swell. Don't hide your tears. Let them flow. Sometimes there's healing in your tears. Those who sow in tears shall reap with joy. And I believe that the oil of joy is the anointing that God wants us to walk in and to live from in 2024. And the same way that Jesus was anointed with the oil of joy and the oil of gladness, that we could just bring that little jar to him tonight. That Lord, I thank you for how you've touched me, but God, I need you to touch me again. And Lord, if you touch me tonight, I'll continue to be your touch in the lives of others. Lord, however you move upon me, I'll give you permission to move through me. And that 2024 would be the year of the oil of joy. It says in Proverbs 15:23 that a man has joy by the answer of his mouth. Amen. And so I don't want to keep you guys too long. I just saw the clock. Hallelujah. God bless. I try not to look at it very often. But how many of you tonight say, I'd like to see my bread blessed? I need my heart to burn. How many of you tonight say, you know what? I'm thankful for the old wine. I'm thankful for where I've been and the joy that I've had, but I need some of that new wine. I need some of that new wine. And I need some of that oil. How many of you are here tonight, you say, I need healing in my body? If you're here tonight, you need healing. If you're here tonight, you need hope. If you're here tonight, and you say, listen, I need my heart to burn again. I recognize that my heart's grown cold. See, one of the things Jesus talked about in the last day, he said in Matthew 24, that in the last days, many will become offended. Check. And their love will grow cold. And when their love grows cold, they'll raise up false voices. But the end can't come until the gospel of the kingdom is preached. And see, the great theme of the gospel of the kingdom is it's not just about going to heaven when you die. That's salvation. And salvation is a part of the kingdom. But the kingdom is to see his kingdom come, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. To heal the sick, to cast out devils, to raise the dead, and to cleanse the leper. And it all flows from that oil of joy. If you're here tonight, in any of those areas that I've talked about, you're like, you know what? I need that. I've got a little jar. But if the Lord will fill this jar, I'll pour it out to every person I come in contact with. I'll go to my neighbors. I'll go to my coworkers. I'll give away what I've got. I'm here tonight, and I don't have a whole lot of hope in my heart. But I recognize the God of hope wants to fill me tonight. I want you to stand up and just come to the front. And Bishop and the prayer team and some of our folks, I know Pastor Tina's here, Pastor Joshua, Pastor Janet, some of our prayer team could come down, some of our Kingsway College students. And we just want to simply just, anyone here tonight that is in need of breakthrough. Anyone here tonight that is in need of healing. Anyone who is here tonight that is simply in need of what only God can do for you. We want to take time just to minister His oil to you tonight. Amen? If you're here tonight and you have need of nothing, that's amazing. This is the part that we empower you to be part of the team and to begin stretching forth your hands to each and every person and begin to pray in the Spirit. Begin to pray for them. Begin to send that word to them. Let's begin to give the angels something to work with as we begin to start speaking words of faith. God, I thank you for these jars. I thank you, Lord, that you promised that the threshing floors would be full of wheat, that the vats would overflow with new wine. And Holy Spirit, we're stewards of your oil. This is your anointing, Holy Spirit. And we may not know everything going on in every person's life, but you do, Holy Spirit. We don't need to pray the perfect prayer. We just need a perfect touch from the perfect one. We invite you, Holy Spirit. Just begin to start making your way down to where people can come out of the aisles. Maybe we could slide some of these tables back just so there's plenty of room at the altar, Bishop.
I want someone to go to our bookstore. Who's here tonight that can acquire the oil that we have in our bookstore? If I'm the only one here that can do it, I'll go do it, right? I got the key. Yes, we have oil. I want everybody to understand this is a special occasion. And what we're going to do right now is the first of the year, this congregation all got oil and brought it in here. And we lifted our oil up. We all prayed at one time. And we lifted up the oil that was the corporate oil. And everybody pointed their hand to it so that it would be blessed oil. And we asked the Lord to do it.
So everybody brought some of their oil?
Everybody.
And together the oil became one?
And what we
this is amazing.
We did it all at one time.
I love it.
Everyone had it. And we've got oil that I'm getting brought in here right now.
What a beautiful blend.
That was oil that we prayed over and we lifted it up. Everyone prayed. And I believe for such a time as this.
Jesus.
What we're going to do is I'm going to give it to Pastor because now it's the body of Christ. This is not just Guiding Light. We had other churches that may have been here, but I don't know. But tonight I know that the Lord is here with us and we're going to use that oil right now. I'm going to submit that to Pastor Jason and he will distribute it. He will distribute it as he sees fit. They're getting that oil. Do you know? You got someone that's doing it? I'm sorry. What's that? She's going to get Deacon Boyd's getting it. Minister Stephanie's getting it. She's going to bring it. Bring those large jars over. And what I'm going to do now, what we do is we have that oil that I'm telling you, we all prayed for it. We're going to pour some of that out. I'm going to put it in a container. Give it to Pastor Jason. Now it's not just what's at Guiding Light.
Wow.
I'll get you to pray over before we use it tonight.
Yeah.
So it's a fresh anointing tonight.
Fresh anointing.
And lay hands. Cause we want to believe for healing tonight.
Jesus.
We want to believe. Is that the one that we had in the bookstore? No, I don't. I've got a big container.
I like that. You got like a spray bottle. Let's get a super.
Well, this is how we can distribute a little bit of this.
Beautiful.
Okay. So this, there we got it. Now, but I want.
We can squirt it from a distance. This is going to be fun.
Listen,
they'd be slithering out of here. It'd be right.
I'm submitting to him tonight.
That's trouble.
But it's the body of Christ is one.
Amen.
I got my mic on right now.
Okay. Amen.
Not yet. Come on, give me some more back there. She may have gone, but here you have this. You got the church tonight. I'm giving it to you, and you do as you would. Kingsway. GLC together, you got it, bro.
Well, why don't we minister together? Can we do that? Can you pray with me? Pastor Tina, if you can come with us. Pastor Joshua, Pastor Janet, you guys know a whole lot about the oil. And so we've got some of our pastoral team here, and Let's do this. Again, new wine's in the cluster. Cluster up, y'all.
That's something I want you all to know, too. I had not gone over that scripture that he talked about in the cluster, because I told him, I said, I could tell Kingsway was here, because when we came in, everybody was up front together. I said, your folk must be here, because my folks scattered. He said, because he said the power's in the cluster. Mm-hmm. And I got to thinking, I didn't know what he meant, but I know what it means now. Guy in light, you better start remembering, y'all scattered all over this place. Come Sunday, you need the cluster.
Hey!
Okay, come on. All right, you talk more about
it. Amen. Come on. Hey, those of you who are here, lead the way. You see somebody sitting by themselves, grab them by the hand, say, come on, y'all. See, because sometimes somebody needs someone who's been there to get them someplace they've not gone before. Oh, hallelujah.
This is what we use, and of course, we poured some into here, into this, but this represents, we have two of those, of how much we prayed over the oil. And I've studied a whole lot more about oil. There is power,
in
the anointing oil. And then I did not know, I'll tell you this, is my mic not working yet? Okay, because I don't want him to ask you that.
I got to slap mine like this sometimes.
But the one scripture that he brought up, I didn't even know, talked about the new grain and the wine.
Joel
2.
That's the precursor to the outpouring.
But see, what I was doing was following what I felt, the leading of the Holy Spirit, when I added it there. And when you brought Joel up, I said, wait a minute. It's in line with what the scripture is.
See, I was just Peter to your Joel. This is that.
That is correct.
Hey.
What it is. Because I just said, I told the congregation, I'm doing it because I feel led of the Lord to do this. I didn't know a scripture. I just felt led. But I had to get with my brother.
Come on.
So that it could be more clear to me. That's why we need each other.
Amen. Amen.
We need each other, brothers and sisters. Come on. Okay, you got to go.
How many of you need healing? If you need healing, I feel like that's the first thing we really need to go after. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Corey, thank you so much. You got to warm me up them steps. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I'm going to have some of my ministry team come alongside the GLC ministry team. That beautiful blend of the oil. There it is. Right now, Lord, I thank you for alignment. Alignment in the neck and in the back right now. Lord, I speak right now to the hips to come into perfect alignment right now. Right now, there's pain leaving that right knee in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Whew. All of a sudden, as soon as I said pain leaving the right knee, I felt my heart. It was almost like I felt like a beat, like two beats on top of each other in my heart, on the inner side of my heart. Who's here tonight that needs a specific healing in your heart? And listen, we're going to get to emotional in a moment, but it was you right here, huh? Let your heart swell with joy. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Jesus. Oh, man. God, I thank you that merry hearts do good like medicine. Again, if you need healing, I want to specifically pray for healing first, and then we're going to come back and minister. It's your heart. Can you put your hands on your heart? Where's Teresa? Come on, Teresa. Put your hand on her heart, could you? Oh, thank you, Jesus. You know, when we get saved, we ask Jesus to come into our heart, and Jesus is the healer. And yes, there's a physical healing in the heart, but honestly, there's an emotional right now to where there's a lot of things you've been carrying where your heart has become so heavy. And I want to tell you, you came in with heaviness, but God is sending you out with a garment of praise. You can't control the spirit that comes at you, but you can choose to put on the garment of praise. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, man. I command this heart, Ezekiel 36 says, I'll give you a new heart
a new heart. I command right now the working of the creative miracles right now, God. Lord, I thank you, Holy Spirit, for the forming and the fashioning of a new heart, a new spirit, God. And Lord, I thank you in the name of Jesus, Lord, right now for the pumping of that heart, God. I speak right now where the ventricles have been blocked up, where even arteries have been clogged. I see an opening of arteries right now. I see blood beginning to flow freely. I even see where there had been even like plaque buildup, even in the arteries, beginning to be cleaned out and cleared out. Holy Spirit, I thank you, Lord, that revelation is like Roto-Rooter in our heart, God. I thank you that the eyes of his heart right now would be open. There it is, there it is, there it is. There it is. Ooh, there it is, there it is, there it is. What do you feel right there, sir?
Burning sensation.
Yeah. Oh, that's, oh, ha, 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 ha. Our hearts burn within us when he spoke, God. Lord, we bless the burning. 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 We bless, bless, bless. Whoosh. Thank you. There it is. Ooh, joy. Isaiah 60 says, look and see, and your heart will swell with joy. Joy. And the abundance of the seas. That's when you pray for sons and daughters. The abundance of the sea will come to you and the wealth of the Gentiles. God, I thank you for the blessing of answered prayer. I speak right now, loose from the infirmity right now. I speak right now, Lord, right now, every nerve ending to begin to function and fire in the name of Jesus. Right now, I break the back of paralysis and I speak life. I speak life. I speak life in the name of Jesus right now. Jesus. Oh, ho, ho. Pour it out, Holy Spirit. Pour it out. Oh, that oil of joy. Come on, rejoice and be glad. Rejoice and be glad. Rejoice. There it is.
Hallelujah.
He makes all Hallelujah. Things new. All.
All things.
All things. All things. All things. All things. Come on. Loose from that infirmity. Loose from that spirit of infirmity right now. Loose from that infirmity. See, Jesus spoke to a woman with a spirit of infirmity that was bent over. And even when the spirit left her, she had to learn to walk in a new way. God, I thank you for a loosing for the spirit of infirmity. Pastor Janet, can you pray with Pastor Tina? If she's, Pastor Janet, if you, or Sarah, Pastor Sarah, one of you. Lord, right now. Hallelujah. 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 Completely loose from that spirit of infirmity right now. Completely loose from that spirit of infirmity. Every entanglement right now. Blessing. The Lord has been highlighting two prayers for us over the past 3 weeks, the loosing of the tongue of liberty and the releasing of the sound of freedom. And see, there's been a spirit of fear that has tried to grip people from not saying what's in their heart to say. And I want to tell you right now, there's something on just simply speaking the name Jesus. The name of Jesus. You can't say Jesus and frown at the same time. It's impossible. You'll pull something. Hallelujah. Father, right now, God, I just speak to Ray. God, I command right now that left side right now. Father, in the name of Jesus right now, for every nerve ending to come alive in the name of Jesus right now. Hallelujah. There it is. There it is. Holy, 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 holy. Is Jane Draper here? Jane, can you come? Holy, holy, holy. That holy fire. It said in Romans 1:4 that Jesus was declared to be the Son of God by the Spirit of holiness and resurrection from the dead. And there's something about where God is highlighting holiness in this season, to live consecrated, to live separate. Holiness is not legalism. Holiness is loving the things that God loves. Holiness is saying, I've been bought with a price. And we bless that holiness in this season. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I thank you for that revivalist anointing. I thank you for that revivalist anointing, Lord, that evangelistic call with signs and wonders. God, I thank you for the prophetic insight, God. I thank you for the fire coming on his feet right now. Fire coming on the feet. Pushaka eterabasumbo. Right now we awaken those gifts that are within you in the name of Jesus right now. There it is. Oh, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost. Fresh prophetic utterance. Fresh. Fresh oil. And we want to hear what God is doing. We want to hear, just like my brother said, his heart was burning. How many know God said that was going to happen? Caleb, come with me. If you're feeling God already beginning to touch you, when we come to you, I want you to tell me how God is touching, what the Spirit of God is doing in you, because when we acknowledge what God is doing, he begins to increase. Hallelujah. Pastor Joshua, why don't you speak to the increase that comes with testimony?
Whew. Lord, I thank you right now that you are increasing your glory in this place. God, I thank you for the glory of your presence that expands and grows and increases in the very kavod of who you are. Lord, I thank you that even as the anointing